So I'm feeling moved. I feel like we need to sing for a minute before I start talking. Otherwise, I might stress you out. So let's sing for a minute. All right, you all know the Bob Marley tune, yes? One Love? So let's sing it a couple times, and then we're going to change one word. One love, one heart, let's get together and feel all right again. One love, one heart, let's give thanks to the Lord and we will be all right. All right, so those of you at home, I hope you're singing out loud and dancing in your living rooms. Let's change one word. Love becomes law. Law. One more time. One law, one heart. Let's get together and feel all right. One law, one heart. Let's give thanks to the Lord and we will be all right. Let's get together and feel all right. There are so many headlines right now, y'all. So many headlines. Anybody feeling a little shook by headlines? We sang this to remind each of you there's one law. There's one law for us to get ourselves in alignment with. Everything that moves from that is going to help us be all right. So please remember that. There's one law. One law we abide in. It's God's law. Remember that. As we move forward, we're going to be continuing our talk about creating beloved community. And in that creation of beloved community, when we align ourselves with the one law, it requires us to behave as if oneness were true. Right? Which is why Jan shared with us being impeccable with your word. Because being impeccable with our word means that we are behaving as if our words have impact to the one. And they always do, right? We know that our words and our thoughts and our beliefs and our values are creative, which means everything that we think, say, do, allow in our own consciousness is creating this oneness. So we each take responsibility in that. So I share this story in the spirit of that. Rev. Angel Kyoto Williams, who is a Buddhist teacher and activist, shares a story in her book, Radical Dharma, a conversation she had. And she says, this young brother said when I was at Buddha Fest, a conference held in DC, that spiritual community is like a white finishing school and people are just figuring out how to be nice to each other. And she responds to him, but it's all within confines of Puritan values of whiteness foisted upon the country at large, which are to not interrupt, to not confront, to not challenge, to not say things when you see things. Right?
Yep.
Right?
Yep.
So I'm going to share a story, and actually share two stories. Let me take you back some years ago in this community, before we had made 15 agreements to be conscious together. I was confronted by a community member who said that my style of communication was disrespectful. And I listened. And this community member went on to say that because I interrupted, I was disrespecting her, and she would not be able to participate if I continued. And then I want to take your attention back to the gossip share and how Don Miguel Ruiz talked about how misinformation shared inappropriately, especially when it is convicted as right, can become like a poison that infects a community. So that story began to spread. And then that story festered and bubbled and grew until the story became Reverend Amani is intimidating and doesn't know how to lead with others. Okay. And the story, and I'm going to keep using the word story, continued to travel through the leadership of this community and continued to come back to me in these really odd ways. And in meetings and in council meetings and in one-on-ones, and this idea began to grow, right? That I was disrespectful, that I was intimidating, that blah, 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 blah. And so the way I chose to handle that story, the way I chose to use my words at that time, was to, as gently as I could, as quietly and as steadily as I could, without like doing too much disruption, to introduce the idea that maybe that story was untrue. Maybe interrupting doesn't mean disrespect. Is that possible? Maybe my style of communication is based on some values that I hold. And I just offered the thing until it escalated in me boo-hooing in a council meeting, trying to explain myself.
Yucky.
Yucky. Super yucky. And I had to go get a gym membership to process. Sure did. I was lifting heavy things, y'all, lifting heavy things. But what I didn't do was speak up. What I didn't do was say, yo, this is some bullshit based in white supremacy. And y'all need to work it out and stop putting it on me. I did not do that. I got a gym membership. I used all my ministerial skills to talk everybody down. Some years later, quite recently, there was a situation in our community where there was an incredible volunteer and donor who was serving in leadership. He was white, heterosexual, cisgendered, wealthy. Ticked all the privilege boxes, right? And I started to notice there were these odd interactions happening in meetings, in conversations, people coming to me on the side about his directives. And I just continued to sit with it, like, this is odd. I wonder why people who think someone's sharing their ideas and their opinions and what they think might be possible, why are those becoming directives to people? Oh, people are having an odd reaction to him, and I don't understand why. Until it escalated, again, that misinformation, right? That misperception of what is true began to spread and began to bubble and fester and poison until finally in a conversation, and I know Jeff won't mind me telling on him. In a meeting with Jeff, we're having a conversation, and Jeff says, you know, Jeff and I had agreed to make some changes about what we were each overseeing. We were swapping some programming that he was going to oversee one thing and I was going to oversee another. And then he says to me, well, are you going to tell him? And in my head, I was like, what the hell is he talking about? I ain't got to tell nobody. I'm the boss. Inside voice, right? So I go home and I am sitting with this and I am like in deep confusion, which is not a thing that happens to me often. I'm in deep confusion, like, what the hell is going on? Why are people spinning up and having these reactions and relationship with this man? And I said to my sweetheart at the time, What do you think it is? I mean, he's white, he's older, he's a baby boomer, he's wealthy, you know, he's heterosexual, he's just, oh, shit. He checks all the privilege boxes. When he walks into the room, everybody reacts as if he's the boss. When he says a thing, people take that as a directive because they experience him as the boss because he's got all the privilege. Well, wow. Wow. This misinformation, this misunderstanding is impacting our community negatively. So I called him up and I said, guess what's happening? People think you're the boss. People think you have all the power because you've got all the privilege. And they're reacting to you as if you are more powerful than me. We got to call a meeting. We got to talk about this. We got to bring it into the light. Because what is in the light cannot continue if it is out of alignment with the truth. Yes? Which is why we speak up. So very differently than all those years before, I called a meeting. And he said, which I thought was the most brilliant answer, maybe I should wear a t-shirt with all the boxes checked. Just so like we're all clear when I walk in a room, there's some stuff going on. And that's how light it became. We had a hard conversation. We had to say hard things to one another. The leadership, especially my white-skinned leadership, which is the majority of them, had to go and unpack some stuff and do some self-inquiry. And then we moved on. No poison, no festering. Peace became possible because I spoke up. And when we believe the story that spiritual community is a finishing school, when we believe the story that the best way to be is nice, we actually participate in spreading gossip. We participate in spreading misinformation that acts like a poison, that acts like a silencer, where we don't feel safe or supported in saying the hard things that we know to be true. My commitment to myself when we began this series on crafting beloved community was I wanted these Sundays, the Fridays, the ways that we interact online to be real. This couldn't just be theoretical. So I made an agreement with myself that I was going to say hard things and tell tough stories so that we all could then maybe grasp these ideas more fully and understand that this thing called spiritual community is real and that we unpack the beliefs and the values and the ideology that support injustice the same way we would unpack any other misbelief in our spiritual work of becoming more conscious. Rev Angel in her book went on to say, because I guarantee you that most of the racism that is occurring and most of the really pervasive presence of white supremacy that gives rise to the discomfort that the BIPOC folks are feeling and the misalignment that BIPOC folks are feeling in our communities is happening in the presence of perfectly good people, but we've all acquiesced to minding our business, and that's not liberation. Yep. We cannot mind our business. We cannot allow ourselves to spiritually bypass, close our eyes to what it is we see. We have to be willing to confront, to challenge, to interrupt. I would add to disrupt. If anything the headlines are pointing us to is, I believe we've been invited to some disruption. Right? I believe we've been invited to get more clear than we've ever been about the laws we will follow and the ones we will not. Yes? The values that we will question, that we've taken as fact, that we've believed based on the societies and the families we were raised in that are the best way to be, to be nice, to not rock the boat, to be quiet. We don't even like loudness, right? I was at a restaurant, this was years and years and years ago, with a bunch of musicians who are already loud people. And there was a group of us sitting in a restaurant and one of us was being really loud and obnoxious. And a friend of mine said to her, wasn't me. I heard you. And one of my friends said, you know, shh. Quiet down, you're being too much. Ain't, was his response. I love that. To this day, when somebody is like trying to dim my light or make me small, ain't. It just takes one word to be clear, right? Ain't. So when somebody tells me my body is not my ain't, like, it's so simple when we're clear, when we use our voices, when we stay in alignment with what we know is true. Anything that isn't that ain't. Ain't. It's just a straight no. No is a complete sentence. And then we keep it moving. We say it out loud. We allow ourselves to be a stand, an out loud stand for what is true. This is what actually gives us peace. When I'm not speaking my words, all those years ago when I did not say what should have been said, I had to get a frickin' gym membership to try to hang on to my peace. That's ridiculous. I ended up using my energy and my resources to behave, to fit in, to follow the rules, to honor a different way of being that was not mine. It was unnecessary. And when we free ourselves to just say the hard thing and challenge what needs to be challenged and speak our truth in whatever set of circumstances or company we find ourselves in, oh my God, we're in flow. We align ourselves in the power, in the presence of the truth of the one. And that just gets to be in flow and it's uninterrupted. It's not misused. We're not having to take that power in order to tamp ourselves down, in order to stop any waves from happening. That power then becomes free to be used for good. And I think the thing to remember in community spaces, especially diverse community spaces that are white majority, is we've got to be even more courageous in truth-telling. We have to be more willing to be uncomfortable and say hard things and challenge one another to be like, is that true? Does that way of being have to continue? Am I willing to look at my stories and recognize them as stories rather than facts? Recognize them as opinions rather than righteousness. When I do that, I make room for more wholeness. I make room for these, what seem to be opposing perspectives or different ways of being, to stretch me. to stretch me a little wider, to hold more than maybe I thought I could, to hold more people than maybe I thought I could. This is required work to create beloved community. And it starts with self-inquiry. It starts with getting honest with ourselves about, did I give up my peace in that moment? Did I decide to be right rather than connected? Which I think we choose a lot. Ernest Holmes, the founder of Science of Mind, our teaching, defines peace as an inner calm so complete that nothing can disturb it. The peace which is accompanied by a consciousness of power. I want you to think about that for a minute. I want you to think about how this man brought together power and peace. A peace that is unshakable happens when we are consciously making use of the power of our divinity. When we are standing unapologetically, authentically, uniquely as a life of the divine, we have a power that cannot be shook, a peace that cannot be disturbed. And when we allow circumstances, people that we may be in relationship with, to shake our peace, it is a guarantee that we've stepped out of our power. And the self-inquiry that is required is to go, oh, I think I might have stepped out of my power. I'm shook. And here's the good news, you are shook, you're gonna be shook, and shaking will continue to happen. Cause life. But we have this power, this peace that we can always return to, and we allow the shookenness to be an indicator. It's like the engine light is on, right? Oh, I'm shook. Okay, let me go within and see what's happening. Let me go within and see if I can realign and recenter and reground and pray myself back into my power, the one power, the absolute power. And from that place of peace, from that conscious power, I can now move forward. I can do whatever it is that impulse of love is moving me to do now that I have realigned myself with it. And it may be to shout your truth with a sign on a street. It may be to get your wallet out and start paying for abortions for women who need them. That impulse of love will move you in right action, but you have to be in alignment with it. You have to remember that your power is here, ain't got nothing to do with law created by humans. Nothing. And I want you to take a minute right now. We're gonna take 2 minutes because I have two questions. First, I want you to think of a place you are shook right now. Easy. And then I was thinking, do you need to close your eyes to find it? Probably not. Probably not. Take a minute, beloveds, and just pick one of the ways you are shook right now. And then bring that shookness into your conscious experience. Don't resist it. Don't shut it out. Take it off the shelf you've put it on and feel it. And then I want you to breathe underneath that. I want you to let go of the story you may be telling about it. And breathe a little deeper and touch the peace and the power that is still there. And then I want you to ask your very divine, powerful nature, what is mine to do? How can I be a stand and a life for love as a result of this shook? And you allow yourself to be guided by that, even if it's scary. Even if you have to say hard things to people you love. Even if you decide that you were willing to put your body in danger of violence, because that is what love is moving you to do. The next thing I'm going to ask you to do from this centered, powerful place is to think about the story you're telling. The story that you might be believing that is even moving you to be shook. And consider from our book of 15 agreements, hallelujah for that book, separating fact from story. Facts are objective data. Facts are what a video camera would record. Facts are unarguable. So take a minute in your shookness as you are looking and inquiring within. What are the facts of your circumstance, your situation? What are the facts, not the story? What are the facts about your situation that would show up on a camera if it had been recorded? They are just what is happening without any meaning. So no meaning about your facts yet, just facts. Stories are interpretations of the facts. Stories include all of our judgments, our opinions, our beliefs, our values that we take from the facts. All stories are made up. All stories are made up. Whether you consider your story a good story, a righteous story, it is made up by you. They are not true. They are simply the way we see the world. And when we understand that we are making up stories about the facts, that we are the ones who assign the meaning, we can actually get liberated from that. We can find our piece of freedom in that meaning making because we can be at choice now about what stories we make up, about what meaning we give the facts. Once you understand that you and others make up stories all the time, and then you believe that your stories are actually facts, then you are free. Free to shift. And we shift by holding our stories gently. And knowing that our stories are just stories that we make up based on our set of beliefs and ideas and values and often our baggage and our trauma. But when we realize that we're just making up stories and then everybody else is also making up stories, making meaning, then we have a place to meet. We can meet in this place with the goal of connection rather than the goal of being right. Had I had the courage those years back to say, you know what, I have a story about what you're telling me. My story is that if I disagree with you and confront you with the racism inherent in what you are saying to me, that we will no longer be able to be in community. That's the story I had. But was it a fact? Not a fact. I could have confronted breaking the Puritan value. I could have challenged breaking the Puritan values and said, you know what, this is BS, and I love you, and I have absolute respect for you. So the meaning you are making about my interrupting is an untrue story. Let's find a better way to communicate with one another that works for both of us. So that we can be in connection. Because as soon as I chose not to speak up, we were no longer connected. We might have been sharing space, but there wasn't connection. We stopped being in relationship because that now stood between us. I would not call that beloved community. But when we can get honest with ourselves about what we are making things mean, the stories we are telling, and then share them with one another, all of that is how we create beloved community. And that we can even laugh at the stories we're telling ourselves. Or we can even say, wow, I didn't know that's what that meant to you. And I'm sorry. But what if it didn't mean that? So your homework this week is I want you to get honest with yourself about a story you are telling about this community. And if you're new to us, I want you to find a story you are telling about any community that you are a part of. Just pick one. If you're feeling really good and you can move through the one, do another one. I want you to pick a story, and I want you to separate your story from the facts. Which takes practice, because I've done this with many, many people, some of you very sitting in this room and probably on the other side of that camera. And we hold on to our stories. And it's hard for us to separate the facts from the story. Because we're like, they did this and it means they're an asshole. And you cannot tell me otherwise. I'm like, could it be possible that you're telling an untrue story? So really sit with the stories you're telling and separate them from the facts. And for those of you feeling courageous, I want you to pick a story that's real and maybe even recent that has happened in this community. And once you've done the work of separating the facts from the story, I want you to go to the person it involves. Yes, ma'am. We're crafting beloved community. This is not just theoretical. And I want you to say, you know what? I'm telling a story about this interaction we had. This is the story I'm telling. And I want to be in connection with you. So I really needed to share this with you. And that's it. You don't get to change them. You don't get to go back to the past and change the story, change the facts. You get to just vulnerably share for the purpose of connection the story you're telling. And let it be. Who's in? Some of you are looking at me like, yeah, homework. I'm not doing that. All right. And I want to leave you with, in case it wasn't clear, Puritan values of whiteness that have been foisted on this country are not the best values. That's a story. It is not a fact. So let us anchor this in prayer together. A prayer for courage, a prayer for powerful peace. Because what I know about the Holy Blessed One, it is the greatest power in the universe. It is always moving for good, and it is moving right now as me and as you and as life itself unfolding on this planet right now. And because this absolute power is the only lawmaker, I know that you and I each say yes to abiding the law of spirit. I know that you and I each say yes to doing what must be done in our own beings and consciousness so that we can more fully plug into this power, so that we can more fully say what needs to be said, allow love itself to move us in right speech as loudly as we need to. And I know that because God is good, every one of us does this and makes the difference. Begins to bring more good, more connection, more community into the manifest reality. That's how it works. And I am wildly grateful. I am grateful beyond words, beyond measure, beyond feeling, to be in community with you, to be connected in this holy work of wholeness, of oneness, knowing that it makes all the difference, knowing that because of that, yes, because of the labor we do together, the world we want to be living in comes into being. I'm wildly grateful for this truth. I am wildly, wildly privileged in this community, and I just allow that to continue to ripple out, to blossom, and to make way. Anchor this with me deeply in your knowing by saying, and so it is.
So it is.